My name is Jonathon Banks. I'm an environment artist with Telltale Games. Thank you all very much for coming to this session today. I just wanted to remind a few of you right now that we don't want to record anything, and also to fill out your evaluations after this. That would be great. So I work for Telltale Games. I've been there for about 4 years now, and I helped define the visual art style for The Walking Dead. This world for the mature franchise. So how many of you have played The Walking Dead game so far? Awesome. Very cool. For those of you who haven't, I'm going to start by showing a trailer that showcases the visual art style we achieved.
Rated M for mature.
Message one.
Oh my God, finally. I don't know if you tried to reach us. All the calls are getting dropped.
I think that might be a little while.
He's bitten! We gotta throw him out!
I'm gonna kill him, Cat!
You wanna get violent, old fuck? Well, come on!
I don't know who you are or what you did, but you better become a better liar.
So today I'm going to be talking about the art of The Walking Dead and the approach we at Telltale took to make it happen. The Walking Dead IP is about survivors living in the aftermath of a zombie apocalypse. It's originally a comic created by Robert Kirkman with illustrated works by Tony Moore and Charlie Adlard. Telltale's The Walking Dead is based on the comic book universe. So typically, most post-apocalyptic games on the market are gritty and realistic. If you look up zombie game or zombie apocalypse online, you get something like this. With the exception of Plants vs. Zombies, it all looks pretty much the same. The imagery is bleak, desaturated, and muted. Before The Walking Dead, Telltale is a company best known for comical, lighthearted adventure games such as Tales of Monkey Island, Sam & Max, Puzzle Agent, and Back to the Future. So going from games like these to The Walking Dead was a difficult task. So how did we do it? Pre-production. The general consensus during pre-production was that we wanted to create a unique-looking game that was familiar to the comics, but also had that strong illustrated style seen in most Telltale titles. Looking at the comic, we were inspired by its bold compositions and classic comic book art style. We really felt that the hand-painted textures and stylistic lighting would be a really good fit for this franchise. Inspired, a few quick concepts were made. These were some of the only concepts made during pre-production. To move the production forward, we decided to create a 3D environment based on one of these concepts. We used the morgue concept as seen here because it visually represented what we were looking to achieve and was the most graphic. The end result was this. This art stayed true to the illustrated concept, drew inspiration from the comic, and worked well within the Telltale engine. This art inspired the team and excited the company. Most importantly, it moved the production forward. At the time, I was working on Jurassic Park and Puzzle Agent, so I did a lot of this during my lunch break. And this is one of the first pieces of art that was created for the game. The fundamental techniques that were used to create the environment art were then passed on to the character department in order to create our first zombie. Sharing and evolving the artistic process utilized by both the character and environment art allowed us to create a cohesive world that fully immersed the player. This is really important to me. I really wanted all assets to really seamlessly fit together. After showing this work to Robert Kirkman, he was super enthusiastic with what we were doing and excited. With a few assets to work with, our cinematics and design department put together the following prototype.
Someone else is here?
Oh, thank God. You didn't lead them to us, did you?
No. No, I don't think so.
Look, we need help here. She's having a baby. Wait a minute. Where'd you come from?
I was looking for medical supplies. This guy in my camp, he...
Shit, behind you! Maybe they didn't hear that.
So I hope one day you'll be able to see that whole prototype with it in its entirety without it being cut down. But one thing we learned from that was that we could tell a mature and engaging story with stylized art. We also learned that the environments and the characters fit cohesively together. The art process. Every major element in the game started with a concept. This included both character art and environment art. These illustrated works would then be translated into 3D. So you can really see how true we stayed to these concepts. We really tried to recreate what we saw. This was the first screenshot we ended up sending out to the public. It was during Comic-Con, and I was a little bit nervous at first. I wasn't too sure how the public was going to respond to this, but it was insanely positive. In fact, I didn't see one negative comment. The only thing I saw was people started complaining about the banner ads that had surrounded the articles. So with this positive response, it was really inspiring to us. We knew we had created a unique and beautiful world that got people excited and wanting to see more. In some cases, there really just wasn't time for a concept, so we looked to the comic for inspiration. Herschel's farm was an example of an environment that we did not get a concept for at first, so we looked to the comic. This is a scan from the comic, and you can see how it was recreated in 3D. Stayed really true. And even though we didn't have a concept at first for this environment, we were able to create something really beautiful. Breaking down the art further, the following techniques provided solutions for visually striking real-time art. These included handcrafted line work, colorful textures, and atmospheric lighting. Handcrafted line work. Working on the Puzzle Agent series and having developed the 2D techniques used to create Graham Annable's unique style in 3D, I wanted to take a similar approach to the art creation for The Walking Dead. In Puzzle Agent, all line work was painted directly onto textures and then applied to models. No procedural techniques were used. So this was all done in 3D. And looking at what we learned from this, we were able to apply it to The Walking Dead. So as you can see here, the line work was painted directly onto the models. And I hope these turntables really show you what handcrafted line work looks like. We kept our line work loose because it more closely resembled that of the comic and could be easily adapted by all artists in the studio. So this is how it's applied to characters. And you can see how it's also applied to environments as well. Later into production, we got a new shader that showed what procedural line work and shading looked like. However, it felt too computerized and took away from the player being completely immersed in the Walking Dead universe. Therefore, we decided not to use it. Now, I thought that was a really good approach, but lately we've actually had a little bit of time to experiment. We took basically the best of The Walking Dead, and we took our procedural shader, and with you can see right here, we just released this yesterday. This is our new franchise that we're developing. And the reason I'm showing this is because everything we do at Telltale is really an evolution of what we've learned from our past products. So working on various projects like Puzzle Agent and Jurassic Park, really learned a lot about the art style for that. That was also applied to The Walking Dead. And you can see where we're taking it now. But that's the future. Colorful textures. Unlike the flat colors in Puzzle Agent, The Walking Dead really needed to have another dimension to its palette. So as you can see from these textures, there's an incredible amount of saturation and detail. There's also what I'd like to call crafted imperfection into each one of these textures. And that's really because The Walking Dead deals with imperfect characters, with imperfect pasts, placed in imperfect situations. So we wanted to reflect a little bit of that in our textures. You can see how it's applied to one-offs and also characters. So breaking down some of these textures even further, you can see first we used illustrative techniques to really define highlights and shadows. We kept this very loose. Then we would add color variation by overlaying watercolor textures or just painting this directly into the maps. And then, of course, adding line work. And as you can see, when it all comes together in an in-game screenshot, it really helped our model shine. Atmospheric lighting. So one of the most important techniques that glued the entire canvas together was atmospheric lighting. Using the cinematic lighting techniques we learned in making Jurassic Park, we pushed it even further with The Walking Dead. Really, Jurassic Park was the first game where we explored cinematic drama, and we took what we learned from that and applied it to The Walking Dead. So as you can see here, there's an incredible amount of mood and atmosphere with the lighting. We have bold use of silhouettes that really give our lighting a noir look to it. There's a lot of high contrast in here. You can see how it's applied to some of our other scenes. Really lighting where we wanted the player to focus their attention. So we wanted every scene in the game to be unique. Therefore, we created color keyed concept art that could be effectively translated by our 3D artists. This was also a really great way to see where an episode was progressing through color. And as you can see, if you take one of these color scripts and blow it up, you get something like this. And now you can see how it would be translated in 3D. You can see how close we came to reproducing some of these color keys. So breaking down a few of these scenes even further, this is just a scene with models and textures. Then we would light it based on color keyed concept art. You can really see just what lighting does to a scene. There's an incredible amount of mood already. And then once After Effects and final art direction were involved. So we didn't have too much After Effects to work with. Basically, what you're seeing here is the addition of depth fog and a color overlay to help basically pull together some of the colors. We also had used alpha flats in order to showcase glows or light beams. And here's the motor in. Just models and textures, once it's lit, and then with After Effects and final art direction. And one of my favorite scenes, St. John's Dairy. In some cases, you can see some of these textures are gray. We ended up colorizing them in the engine with lighting, and then with fog, After Effects, and final art direction. So you can see there's a tremendous amount of mood and atmosphere that we were able to put into our scenes just with lighting. Technical constraints. So in order to ship on a wide range of platforms, the following technical limitations were imposed. Environments had a modeling budget of 30,000 verts. This was so we could add more characters on screen. A big part of The Walking Dead is the characters, but we didn't want the environments to be bare or flat. So basically what we did is we resorted to low polygon modeling techniques and used camera-facing flats where appropriate. At first, we had screen-based ambient occlusion, but that was removed, so we ended up baking that into the light maps. Vertex lighting replaced per-pixel lighting. As I went over earlier, we had limited post-processing effects. HDR was removed, and we had reduced light map sizes. This, I think, had the biggest impact on the game. Basically, we had a new compression algorithm, and our light maps basically went from being very sharp and graphic to a little bit soft. However, we didn't let this get to us. We really just focused on what, with the resources we had, and we were still able to create some really beautiful art. This was further, we had our first playtest, and the art received basically some of the highest scores. Production. So we ended up creating these style guides in order to keep the art consistent and production efficient. This is really a great way to provide new artist tutorials on how to adapt to the art style. And within these tutorials, it showed how to create textures, outline modeling constraints, and included brushes that could basically be easily shared throughout the entire art department. In some cases, there were some tutorials that basically showed how to create assets very quickly, You could use this train as an example right here. Once it was modeled, line work could be easily applied to it, and then we could throw in a few base textures and move it down through the production pipeline. Later, if time permitted, we could basically paint over these with a polish pass. As you can see, the train now has gone through a polish pass. It has increased contrast, weathering, and details. So the information in these style guides really allowed for quick iterations and the rapid creation of assets. Because of this, the art could be iterated upon when changes to the story occurred without severely affecting the production schedule. This was critical in order to give our writers the freedom they needed to tell the story they wanted to tell in the time that was given to them. So in about a year and a half, we created 78 environments, 45 characters, 2,316 textures, 275 objects, 77 effects, and a zombie factory. At one point, the entire company worked on the project, but the core development team that created the majority of this art consisted of about 6 artists. The final product. Using the resources available to us and embracing our constraints, we created art that successfully aided in the telling of a mature story. By merging the look of the comic with Telltale's familiar illustrative style, we created a beautiful and commercially successful zombie apocalypse. If there's one thing I learned from working on The Walking Dead, it's this. Trust in what you do best as a studio and let that shine through the product. Thank you. And we have time for questions, so if anyone has any, feel free to ask.
Great work, really love it. And I had a question. You commented a little bit about how the final 3D environments were really driven so much by the concept art, the style of the concept art. Could you talk a little bit more about if there were other areas where the concept art team was interacting with the modeling team and the texturing team? Because it almost seems like, as opposed to normally when there's a painting and it might translate to photorealistic textures, here it seemed like there was a lot more overlap.
There definitely was, and even in some cases, they would actually create concepts based on what we had gray boxed. At times, they would actually fill us in with a few textures. They'd come up with some ideas, and that was really cool. We could kind of bounce off of each other in order to create some really beautiful work.
Great, thanks.
One of the things I loved about the game was that the characters were very stylized but still very emotionally expressive, which I think really contributed to how emotionally mature and dramatic the game was and how much everyone liked it. Can you speak to sort of using those very stylized faces to convey these very heavy and serious emotions that we're maybe not used to seeing in characters that don't look very real?
So that's been something that Telltale's been working on since it started, is really creating great characters with a lot of emotion. And that's really what we invest a lot of our technology into.
So what do you do?
there's basically they are able to create style guides that showcase various emotions. And it's really not my department as far as how that is acted out. But it's pretty cool what we're able to do at the company.
When you were creating the art, I've never try to do a visual style like that. Which maps do you use? Was that all diffuse only and emphasis on the line work?
Yeah, so we didn't use any normal maps. It was all diffuse based, no specular maps, basic Lambert shading.
Wow.
Yeah.
Very cool, thanks.
Where will you be this Sunday night?
I've got a date actually, so yeah.
Good choice.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, 5? Okay.
Hi. You briefly mentioned how... everyone's looking at me. You briefly mentioned how, as the episodes would progress, there would be a color progression. Are there any other ways that you progressed and how the story and the place in this story, not the physical location, but like the temporal element of the story, like where the story is progressing and how the characters are feeling, like how that plays into the environment.
Can you repeat the question again?
So how does, in what ways does the tone of the story affect the environment in other ways other than just the color progression in the episode?
Okay, yeah, so I showed a slide earlier that was like the slaughterhouse right in the back of the barn.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we would basically, that's a scene that we really wanted to be scary, so we added a lot more mood into that, and that was reflected really in the concept. So basically, the concept artists would basically see what was going on with the story. They would get a pitch from there. Then they would basically be able to, you know, do what they do best and concept some art out. You know, it should have a lot of mood to it. Where you see sometimes, like in St. John's Dairy, you could see that there wasn't, you know, that it was just in daytime, and you could see how that progressed as the night came. We had a lot of rain and atmosphere. And it's, in some cases, that was just, it just evolved that way. I know when we were first making that specific scene, it wasn't going to be rain. It wasn't going to have any rain or any lightning or anything like that. But as we started making the game, we saw that that was just going to add to a lot. It was going to add to the scene if we added all that contrast in there.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi. You mentioned earlier that you. The art is based off of the comics, mm-hmm. but I wanted to know, did you take anything either during the project or personally from the show at all, like while making the environments?
We looked at the whole IP.
Okay, cool.
And there was also a few other things we looked at. I'm just not allowed to talk about them.
Okay, that's fine. All right, thank you.
But I love the whole series is amazing. So.
Hi, yeah. So my question is a bit about the modularity, I guess. So, like, I saw that I play the game and the environments they look, like, really, really good and really and different. And I noticed that the colors change a lot. So I want to know, like, did you guys reuse any things? Because I know since most of the things were in the textures, like the other guy's question asked, mm-hmm. did you guys reuse a lot of the props, or was it totally unique? Because the environments, they do look, you can really feel the difference in mm-hmm. the in
okay.
the pacing.
So yes, the question was, do we reuse anything, right? Okay, and yes, we do. The trick is to not make it look that way. And I would say that lighting played an integral part with that. You know, one thing that I did was actually create an asset library, and that was that you could easily see. You know, most engines have this basically, where you have all your different assets, and you can easily populate a scene. And that was really helpful with for everything we were doing, especially once we reached like episode 4 and 5, and we, you know, kind of our schedule got crunched. And so, really setting up some of these techniques that we could create environments and scenes really quickly was essential. And then using, you know, a little bit of tech where we could take textures and shift the color around. And then, of course, with lighting. It's amazing what you can do with lighting to cover a lot of that up.
Okay, cool. Thanks.
Yeah.
Speaking of lighting, could you tell us how many lights you needed on average in a scene and what kinds?
So, we had per vertex lighting, but that was all real-time lights. And that was mainly on the characters. For environment specifically, we could use an astronomical number, basically, because it was all baked lighting. We did use ambient occlusion as well when appropriate. So it didn't really matter when it came to baked lighting. In some cases, we were able to override some of the baked lighting with real-time lighting, and that's usually about 4-point lights that we have access to. Yeah. Sometimes less. Depends on if it ships on, like, iPhone or not. Yeah. All right. Is that it? Thank you all for coming. Really appreciate it.